Happy Father's Day, everyone. Especially want to give you a happy Father's Day to all the dads, all the granddads, all the great-granddads. I hope you feel really appreciated today. I like to call this day Man Appreciation Day. If you're a man and you feel appreciated this morning, or just feel appreciated in life, give us a little round of applause. That's all right. Maybe it could be a bit better, but that's pretty good. We're coming to worship our God, who is mighty, who is all-powerful, who knows everything. He's the creator of all the universe, and yet he is our Father. And that's a wonderful truth to dwell on. And that's what the psalmist does in Psalm 68, where it says this: "Come, sing praises to God. Rejoice in his presence, for he is our God, a father to the fatherless, and the defender of all who need protection, the one in whom the lonely find a home, and the prisoner finds release. Bless the Lord, the God of our salvation, who sustains and strengthens us day after day." Isn't that wonderful news to cherish? Doesn't that give us wonderful reasons to celebrate and to worship our God, who is Father? So let's stand together and let's sing praises to him.
Good morning. Welcome. Welcome into God's house. There is a voice.
There is a voice that must be heard. There is a song that must be sung.
A name.
There is a name that must be lifted high. There is a treasure more than gold. There is a king upon the throne. There is one.
Father, thank you for having us in your house. Lord, we've got so much to be grateful for. Thank you, Father, that you love us unconditionally. Thank you that your very character is love. And Lord, we just come into your presence to say thank you for all that you are and all that you've done. Thank you, Lord. I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. But am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Please, Lord, remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. For you say I'm loved, I can't feel a thing. You say I'm strong, when I think I'm weak.
You say I am held, when I am falling short.
Falling short when I don't
belong. Lord, you say I am yours, and I believe, oh, oh, I believe what you say of me. I believe, so I believe.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Tim, come on back up. We got some business to do, right? Or two. You will know that it is Father's Day, but it's not just Father's Day today. It's also a family day, because we have the wonderful opportunity right now to welcome in some new members. I have a long-ish list of people that have become members in the last 6 months or so. So hopefully some of you are here, and if you hear your name, please do come up. I've only got first names written down, so hopefully we won't have too many of the same people coming up. You know who you are. So if Damilona or Arlene or Jason or Gertrude or Errol or Pam or John or Claudia or Moyo or Olivia and Hannah, who were in the 930, so they're not here, or Mavis, if you go by those names and you have recently filled in a membership form, please do come to the front. Do come all the way down towards me. I've backed myself in a corner so you can spread out. And lovely. So this is just Gertrude. It's not you. It's another Gertrude. Lovely to have you up there. Please do take a seat. I know Gertrude because her granddaughter is at the same nursery as my son Hudson, so we have great chats. You've been to church about 3 times. That would be a record in terms of becoming member. We're going to get you soon. Don't worry about that. That's the right Gertrude. Great. And well done. Brilliant. So as I go down, can somebody help me? Michelle, sorry, just because you're a speaker as well. Could you hand these out as I read names? Because muddling through those will take forever. Please just say your name, and then we'll know who you are. Yes.
My name is Errol.
Pam. Pam.
You looked a bit confused there. No, that's fine.
Arlene.
Jason.
Gertrude. Moyo. Are we
getting all this? I'm John.
Now how on earth am I going to get here? Right. Let's push the band out of the way.
Mavis.
Damilola.
Hey, Damilola, good to see you.
And Claudia.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. So, I'm going to... David, I just have to look at... Could you help me move the communion table a bit forward? We've done a risk assessment on this. Okay. So Michelle's just going to hand out membership forms. And we love new members. We love the fact that we're a part of the universal church in Christ. But also, there is what is known as the local expression of being church family. God calls us into his family. He adopts us, as we've been celebrating in the worship. And then we become a part of his household, his church. And it is good, it is right that we recognize a time where someone opts in to be a part of a church and says, this is my church where I want to give myself, my time, my money, my gifts, my prayers. This is where I want to learn. This is where I want to care for others. And we welcome them in. And what we're going to do is Daryl will start playing. We'll continue to worship. And then just like when you go to a wedding, you have a kind of procession. Feel free to come up, whatever age you are, and just embrace them. Just have a moment to talk to them, shake their hand, give them a hug. You guys didn't know this was coming, did you? If you want to run away, you can get to Charlie in the annex and we'll hide you in a room somewhere. But we'll start worship. We'll start with the leadership team. So leadership team, if you want to start coming up, and let's just welcome them. Introduce yourself. This is our family. And let's worship God. Let's stand up.
worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Jesus.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Song we could ever sing, and you're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
We live for you, Jesus.
Jesus, the name above other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you.
Just pray for our new members and also for the children and the youth as they're about to leave to go to their groups in a moment. as we think about the new members, I'm just reminded of these lovely words from Joel Edwards, who said this at a Windrush celebration a couple years ago. And of course, this Thursday, we celebrate the 75th anniversary of Windrush. And he was the director of the Evangelical Alliance. And he said this in one of his prayers: Lord, make us one, but not all the same. And we pray that, Lord. It's so lovely to have a diversity of people coming into our church. We want them to feel that this is their family. And we want them to be able to be as they are in their personalities and their gifting. Lord, just guide them and help us to love them, to embrace them. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity to just to get to know them a bit more, Lord. Help us as a whole church to make a commitment today to invite these people into our homes, into our lives, to be the body of Christ. That we really would feel that sense of affection, that we really are sisters and brothers because of what Jesus accomplished, as we'll be remembering later, as we remember his redeeming work on the cross. We pray for our children and our youth, Lord. Would they be blessed as they go to their groups? And we're so thankful for the teachers and the helpers who labor in love to bring on new disciples so that they may be added when the time is right. We thank you that they're very much a part of our family already, but we pray for that time where they for themselves will declare you as Saviour and Lord. We pray all these things in your wonderful name, Jesus. Amen. Yes. Children and youth, just allow people to come off the stage, and then once they're off the stage, if you are a child between the ages of 0 all the way to about 18, you can go to your groups this way. And why not take a couple of minutes to find out what someone near you is doing during this week? Maybe what they're doing as it's Father's Day, but just get to know someone for a couple of minutes and then I'll call us all back together. Going to come together to look at what we are doing as a church this week and in the coming weeks. Hopefully you're really excited about the summer. Half of you are just waving. You're waving those fans. I don't know if it's helping at all. You're just getting even more hot and bothered. If you feel during the service that you need to put your face in some water, we're happy with anything. Splash someone near you in the sermon. Not that it's boring, because it's really good today. If you feel led to do that, you have my permission. Let's look at what we're doing this week. So the first thing is to welcome you, particularly if you are new. If you've come to the church a few times and you'd like to become a member, as we saw someone came up, then please do fill in one of these connect cards. And this is really if you just want to get to know us, you'd like to meet with a leader of the church, you would like to go to one of our newcomer lunches, details are up there. And you'd like to come to our church DNA course, which runs during a service where we look at our vision and our values and how you can get involved. In order to make sure you know about that, in order to make sure you get a pastoral visit from a pastor, please do fill in one of our connect cards, which I can give you or someone from the welcome team can give you on your way out today. So today, let's look at what's on the plan. We have the youth hangout at 5:30, and that runs just before our Sunday at 7 service, where we're going to be continuing our series on the book of Nehemiah called Brick by Brick Revival. And you also see up there, there is our midweek service for those who are retired, and that's our cameo, and the details are up there. Let's look at prayer. Very excited that we have a prayer room, which I know you'll be hearing about in Michelle's sermon a bit later. And we are starting that on the 1st of July, and that will run for a whole week. In hours, that is 168 hours that we're looking for that prayer room, the cube, to be occupied. Not with people sleeping during the night, but people who are awake and up and interceding for the many things happening in this church and the many needs out there. So please, do book your place, go on the Pearly Week, go on the interactive spreadsheet, and get a slot booked. You can go as a live group, you can go as whoever. It will be really good to see so many involved in praying. Next slide, please. We have our monthly prayer meeting, Heartbeat, an opportunity to come together at 7:30 for an hour and to pray. And we encourage you on that day, if you're able to consider fasting a meal or two or the whole day. That is not eating for the day, and using that time to pray. And in particular, we want to encourage you to pray for the church's outreach. And at the Heartbeat prayer meeting, Helen Harris will be talking about our outreach, including how we're going to look to reach out to those that are soon going to be neighbours at the flats across the road. Okay, if you go to the next slide, you'll see our Pearly Week, which you can access scanning the QR code just by your chair in front of you. And you'll see we've got Positive Life courses, a range of really good courses that help you with everyday life, and also that we're advertising for an interim children's and families worker. Okay, we're going to take up our offering. So if you're helping with the offering today, could you pass out those bags? And the offering bags will go around, and then we will be having our Bible reading. So, Deneen, wherever you are, if you want to come up now, and we will have the Bible reading. And then after that, we're going to hear Michelle, who's going to bring us the word. As Deneen comes up, and as we pass out the offering bags, let me just pray for the word. Lord, we thank you for this morning. It's been so busy, but it's busy with good things, Lord. And we come now to pause, to listen. We long to hear from you, Lord. And we know that's good news because you long to speak to us. And we're amazed each week how you take a servant and by them just looking at your word, you give a message for this specific church. And even this specific congregation. So we pray for Michelle, Lord. We pray for the message that we've already heard in the 9:30, that you will bring it once again. It won't be mere words, but your Holy Spirit will make it alive. That we may know your goodness. That we may encounter you. So Holy Spirit, rest on Michelle now. May she have such peace as she brings with boldness your truth. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. The first reading is taken from 1 John 4, verses 7 to 21. Can you hear me? Okay, thank you. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent us his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us of his Spirit, and we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. This is the word of the Lord.
Struggle with this because I like using my hands to preach. Okay. Oh. Oh. Hey. Yes. Good. Oh, great. Good. Thank you. Okay. Right. Back to the passage. Thank you for the reading. As you would have heard when it was read to us, there's a lot of love in it. And I counted up the number of times love, loves, loved was put in this passage. And 15 verses, they have love in it 27 times. As we've worked through this letter over the last few weeks, you'll have noticed it's full of references to love. In previous weeks, we've looked at authentic love and what Christian love looks like in action. And this passage looks at love again and emphasizes what we've already heard, but he also adds some new things as well. And John goes on and on and on about love because he's passionate about it. He wants his readers to get the message that love is what it's all about. Love, 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 27 times in a few short lines. So let's look at the passage. I know James always encourages you to keep your Bibles open to check on him. You really need to check on me because I've never been to college on this stuff. Please keep your Bibles open. Is that me? First, let's look at what John says about God. Nick Glunn talked on 1 John 1:5 for us, and we saw in that passage that God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. And Nick helped us recognize that this means God is holy and pure and truth. He is excellent in virtue. And now in this passage, John writes, love comes from God. So John is saying God is the origin of love. He is the ultimate source of love. And then verse 8 and 16, we have that famous line, God is love. God's very nature is love. He is all loving. So if God is the origin of love, and his nature and character is love through and through, what does God's love look like for us? What do we know about his love? The Old Testament says God's love looks like this, through numerous stories and descriptions that express the nature of God's love. So in Hosea, we have the tragic story of Hosea's marriage being shattered by his wife's adultery. She ultimately leaves her husband and becomes a prostitute. But with God's prompting, the prophet Hosea takes his wife back, even paying for her to come out of prostitution. God uses this sorry story to say to an unfaithful Israel, his chosen people, my love is like Hosea's. Let's look at Hosea 2, 19 to 20. I will make you my wife forever, showing you righteousness and justice, unfailing love and compassion. I will be faithful to you and make you mine, and you will finally know me as the Lord. God is saying his love forgives. His love redeems. It's unfailing despite what we have done. It's compassionate and merciful. His love is restorative. And then we have the soaring love poem of Song of Songs, where extravagant desire and longing are expressed between a bridegroom and his bride. And scholars believe that the bridegroom expressing his love to his bride here is in an analogy for Christ expressing his love to the church. That's us. Spurgeon called Song of Songs a sacred marriage song between Christ and his church. The bridegroom sees the bride's imperfection but says, to me, you are beautiful, you are my love. We see through Song of Songs that God's love yearns for relationship with us. He's passionate about us. He strains towards the day when the church will become his bride. And despite all our imperfections, he sees us as beautiful. Each one of us is precious in his sight and worthy of love. So the Old Testament is full of God's consuming love for his people, expressed in his compassionate restoration and healing of them, when the church will become his bride. Despite all our imperfections, he sees us as beautiful. We see in the Old Testament God being compared to being a caring shepherd, a tender, loving father. He's described as protector, a redeemer, faithful, gentle, just, merciful. Line after line after line, the Old Testament tells us what God's love looked like. Lamentations 3, 23. The faithful love of the Lord never ceases. Jeremiah 31, 3. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with unfailing kindness. So the Old Testament declares loud and clear, God is love. Let's move on and look at today's passage. What does John say love looks like here? Verse 9, it's on the screen. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. God's love looks like Jesus. Jesus is the visible evidence of God's lavish love for us, love that is self-sacrificing, costly, and generous. And notice the phrase, he showed his love among us. Love, in the person of Jesus, came down to earth to walk and live among people, to serve people, and ultimately to die for people. Why did Jesus do that? Because he loves us. Why did God send his son? Because he loves us. So love is not defined just by the sacrifice of Jesus. It's also defined by the giving of the Father. So, if the origins of love are in God, and God is love, is anyone who loves a child of God, whether they believe in Christ or not? Because let's face it, some Christians don't do a good job of loving others, while some non-Christians do a great job at sacrificial care and love of others. They do a better job at loving others than the church has done sometimes. Throughout these verses, John wants us to hear that human love, however noble and however highly motivated, isn't enough to pave the way to a loving relationship with Father God. Relationship with the Father is solely achieved when we take a step of faith and humbly acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the Savior of the world. Now, I know that I'm talking to a congregation that is largely made out of people who believe this already. But we can get used to hearing these amazing, profound truths. So it is worth us pausing and reflecting on them again. We refresh and feed our love for people by remembering with them the moments of joy, friendship, significant events. So I enjoy looking at photos of people, and it stirs my affection for them as I remember them. And that's what we'll be doing around the communion table later. Pausing, reflecting, recalling and expressing our love and gratitude to the Father for all he's done for us through Christ. Back to the passage. When we declare our faith to Christ, we've taken the first step to truly walking and living in love. But what happens then? Verse 15 says, if anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. Wow. So this says that at the moment of our confession of faith, the Almighty, all-powerful God of the universe comes and lives in us. But how do we know that God is living in us and loves us? And John says, because God has given us his Holy Spirit. Look what Paul says in Romans, two verses on the slide, Romans 8:16, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And 5:5, God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So God's Holy Spirit testifies to our spirits that Jesus is Lord and that we are children of God. And then God's Spirit fills us with God's love. And from that well of love, we can turn outwards to the world and pour love out to others. So to recap, let's look at three main hallmarks of a Christian that we've identified. One is confession of Jesus as the Son of God and our Savior. Possessing the Holy Spirit within us and living in the love of God. What does it look like to live in the love of God? St. Augustine's summary of the meaning of life was this: love and do as you please. What Augustine is saying here is that if love for God becomes the driving forces of our lives, it will influence everything we do and think and say. When his love becomes the primary motivation in our life, our default setting, we are free to do as we please in life because we will want exactly what God wants, and our choices will become His choices. Love will impact our very being and our every action. So love and do as you please. So that's a reason why Jesus said the most important commandment is love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Because if we fulfilled this command completely, we wouldn't need any other commandment. So how does living in love work out in our everyday experience? Verse 16 says we know and rely on the love God has for us. John's deep understanding of God's love for him gave him total confidence in God. And we see this confidence worked out in the lives of all the apostles. They gave up everything to live radical lives for Jesus. They had no fear for themselves. And it ultimately led to imprisonment and martyrdom for most of them. Their lives testified to the truth that there is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear. They were totally convinced of God's love for them and believed completely that Jesus had paid the price for their salvation. So they knew that they were going to be with God in His kingdom when they died. And that knowledge made them fearless in the face of death. And we too, as children of God, can look forward with confidence to standing before God's judgment throne at the end of time and seeing His eyes of love and acceptance on us, welcoming Him home, us home into His kingdom, the bride reunited with the bridegroom. His perfect love drives out fear. And that means the torment of wondering what happens to us after death. Instead, we can live in hopeful expectation of being with God for all eternity. So, we can add a fourth hallmark to what it is to be a Christian. And that is that we live in the hope of eternity. Living in God's love will also reflect in our relationships with others. Says 12, verse 12, no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives us and His love is made complete in us. Look at this verse in the New Living Translation. No one has ever seen God, but if we love each other, God lives in us and His love is brought to full expression in us. Wow. So, if we love each other, the full working out, the multifaceted, the totality of God's love are given full and complete expression through us, the church, His precious bride. Like a carefully crafted diamond reflecting light like a prism, we are called as church to beautifully reflect God's love to all around us. Isn't that awesome? And humbling and overwhelming. God's plan is for us to bring full revelation, full expression of His love to the world. And what could God's complete expression of love look like in us? Well, 1 Corinthians 13, a famous passage, but let's look at it. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. This is costly love. It's about putting others first and our own needs at the bottom of the list. It's about investing time and energy and resources in others. It's about honoring others with our words and actions and to keep on loving in all situations. But what if we don't feel like we love God? We feel spiritually dry, with nothing to give out, no motivation, no resources to love God or others. This week, Peter and I celebrated our 37th wedding anniversary. Thank you. And when we started going out over 40 years ago, I was a student nurse based in a London hospital. And when I was on nights, we used to do a full 7 nights in a row, so I became pretty nocturnal. And it was before mobile phones, as you recognise, over 40 years ago. So the only way we had to communicate was a coin payphone way down in the basement of the nurse's accommodation, or letters, and I really wasn't good at letters. But Peter felt the relationship was worth pursuing and investing in. So he would come up on his motorbike to be with me during my meal break in the early hours of the morning. I know, cute. In fact, he spent many hours biking up and down to the nurse's home in all weathers to be with me. Yeah, I know. Thank you for the odds. I think if he hadn't carved out that time, which was costly for him to do so, our relationship would have dwindled and died. To sustain and grow love needs sacrificial investment, even when you don't feel like it. Yes, we sometimes feel full of faith and joy and love for God, and setting aside time for Him is easier. But other times, like any relationship, be it in a marriage or a friendship or with family, it can become more of an act of will, and it can be costly. But we recognize that giving our undivided attention and energy to someone is good investment because they're worth it. To keep our spiritual lives healthy, we need to give time and space to Father God, focusing on who He is, investing in our relationship with Him, giving space for the Holy Spirit to minister to us and to speak to us. And it might be that we're in such a dark place that all we can do is cry, Father, help, or just to pick up our Bible and read a psalm. But God hears because He loves you. I really enjoy singing this song, Good, Good Father. And there's a line in it which says, I'm loved by you. That's who I am. That's who I am. It reminds me that my primary identity is that I am a loved child of God. So it may be that you feel a million miles away from Him and you hardly touch your Bible or pray or engage with church. But hear God's call of love to you today. Know He loves you. And perhaps this is the day you decide to fan the fire of your relationship with Him, to ask the Holy Spirit to help you live out a life of love for God. And now this is where I do the unashamed plug for 24/7 prayer room. So why not sign up for an hour or two and purposely, sacrificially set time aside to give to Father God? There'll be different stations and materials in the room which will help you pray. For instance, the young people are looking to work to set up an area which will be looking at justice and giving ideas to pray for justice issues. I'm following a video blog of Pete Gregg at the moment. He's actually the founder of the 24/7 prayer movement. And he's on a pilgrimage in Scotland. And I imagine some of you will know about this story already if you're doing the Lectio 365 daily readings. But this week, he talked to a 91-year-old man who was actually a deer stalker, actually. And he started a house of prayer 30 years ago in the wilds of Scotland. And from that place of mission, a little place in the hills of Scotland, was birthed a mission program that now feeds 2.4 million children every day in 18 nations. And Pete Gregg commented, here we see clearly that when people pray and seek God, we catch his heart and we change the world. When we love God and actively pursue time with him in prayer, his Holy Spirit will grow in us love for the things God loves and are on his heart. Out of an encounter with Jesus springs up love for him and a heart for those things he loves. And this love will demonstrate itself in loving acts. So to conclude, God loves us. Do you know that for yourself? Do you want to explore that more? If you'd like to talk to somebody, please speak to Tim or myself after the service. God's love is expressed through us. Do we reflect love to each other, to God's church, to our community? God loves the world. How does that love express itself through us? Do we really love our neighbor as ourselves? Do we pray for our neighbors and the world? Do we serve without expecting anything back? Do we speak about Jesus to others? Do our lives radiate God's love to a broken society? God is gracious, and his heart is for us. The calling to love him and love our neighbors is impossible to fulfill in our own strength. But be of good courage. Take heart. Thank God it's not up to us to manufacture love for him and for others. We have God living in us. His Holy Spirit will guide, strengthen, equip, and fill us. And this profound truth is encapsulated in the words of verse 19, where it says this: we love because he first loved us. Praise God that he is love. And because he is love, and love comes from God, we are enabled to love God and to love our neighbor. Thank you, Father. Amen.
Thank you, Michele. The band are going to come up and we're going to respond to this love that we've heard about. Michele has challenged us to actively pursue God. And as we come to the communion table, we come to what is the hallmark of God's love. God is love. And Jesus is God's lavish grace, his lavish love for us. As Michele said, there's a lot of references to love in that passage. I think there were 27. And I don't know about you, but I've heard a lot of sermons on love. And it was really good what Michele was saying. But so often we can hear about God's love and nod along and think, yeah, we know that God loves us. Through that, we'll love others. But I just wonder, let's just spend time not rushing. We're not just going to have one song. We've got quite a while to respond and to worship God and ask that we will experience his love once again. We're going to take some bread soon. We're going to drink what is grape juice. And I could describe bread to you. I could describe the taste of grape juice, but you need to taste it for yourself. We've heard a wonderful description of God's love. Great illustrations. Now we need to experience it for ourselves. So let's stand and let's worship. Let's just stand and let me lead us in a prayer before we sing and then before we come to the table. So Lord, we just thank you so much for your love, which we've been hearing about. And we know from what Michele was saying that to sustain and to grow in love, we need to make sacrificial investments. And so we just say this morning, whatever it takes to develop our relationship with you, Lord, we're ready and we're committed. We don't want it just to be words in a song. We want it to be our life and our lifestyle. Lord, maybe we need to make a commitment to commit to pray and to start that time now and maybe when it's the 24/7 prayer season. Lord, maybe we just need to rethink our quiet time, which is so often rushed. Help us, Lord, in this time, this holy moment, to stand in amazement once again at the power of your love, the power of your sacrifice. Just call on God now. He beckons us in. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Let's enjoy some time with him.
Spirit, I am free.
Let's just sit down for a moment or two as we come to the cross, as we come to the table, as we come fall down at his feet in amazement of his love, as we think about the symbolism of what these elements represent. The love that defines love, the love of which I hope that we've all experienced today, the love which should change everything, should change our attitudes to life, to each other. If you're helping with communion today, can I encourage you to come up to the front as we'll start to serve the elements. And so we remember at the Last Supper, the Lord Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for each and every one of you. Take it and eat it in remembrance of me." So let's enjoy the fact that we're forgiven, the fact that we're made whole, the fact that we're brought together as one body because the body of Christ was broken for each and every one of us. So as the bread comes around, please do take and eat if you've made Jesus your Lord and Saviour. And if you haven't, why not reach out to the Lord and speak to him about what's on your mind? And I believe he will meet with you. Same way, on that same evening, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of all your sins. So whenever you drink it, drink it in remembrance of me. So we're going to take the cups, we're going to hold on to them as a sign of our unity, as a sign that it is his blood that washes away all our sins, sins past, present, and future. It's all drowned in his love for us because of his blood shed for us, the ultimate sacrifice. Let's remember, let's give thanks, and let's celebrate his love. And we'll drink them when we've all got one. Blood of Christ for our forgiveness.
Bless you, Father.
Let's pray, Lord, we just welcome you here as we continue to worship you. Help us to not be content with our experiences of you so far, however old we are. Help us to press in and pursue you. Help us to never be familiar with your love. Lord, may we just enjoy your presence now as we continue to worship.
Rest in his presence for a minute. Bless you, Father. Bless you, Lord.
Well, you may feel you have a word or a Bible passage, something you think would really edify the church. If you have that, please do come to me at the front, and I'd love to hear what you have, and if it's appropriate, would be great to share it to the church so that we're encouraged as we worship the Lord together.
Bless you, Father. By your Holy Spirit, rest on us, Lord. Draw close to us, Father. Bless you, Father. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you, moving in our midst. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. Bless you, Father. You are here. I worship you.
moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you.
Your presence here, Father.
I've been experiencing a pain in my head this morning and early in the service, and I felt earlier that that God was saying that he wants to bring comfort and healing, and then there was an invitation to bring a word. So if you suffer from head pain, tension, migraines, you might think that, well, that's only a little thing, but God wants, he loves and he knows, and he wants to bring comfort to you and healing. So I'd love to pray for you, if that's you.
Bless you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Father. Don't be shy to come up if you want to respond to that. You don't have to do it right now, maybe when we're singing in a minute. I will trust in you alone. I will trust in you alone. For your endless
we're going to be leaving with God's love in a moment. Just before we do so, I just thought I'd unashamedly name drop someone. You'll know that this Thursday is the 75th anniversary of Windrush, and you may know that there are 10 leading artists who have been commissioned by the King to paint portraits of 10 people they consider pioneers of Windrush. And the reason why I say I name drop is because Heidi's great uncle is one of those people. So if you want to see Heidi's great uncle, Delissa Bernard, you can see him on BBC this Thursday. And he is 100 years old, served in the RAF. And I just thought, before we leave this place, it would be good just to pray about that anniversary, how we celebrate that, and the importance in our hearts to always love and appreciate how people can enrich us and how migration has been so good for Britain. So let's just pray about that before we go from this place. So Lord, I just want to thank you for this fact that on Thursday we can celebrate the many people who came to this country just after the war to help rebuild things. Lord, there's all sorts of stories there of not facing the best reception, with people being quite cruel, quite racist. And Lord, we thank you for how difference enriches things. And we thank you for the society we live in. And we long to be a place where we see how difference enriches. And Lord, in all of this, we pray that the church would rise up, would shine as a place that celebrates diversity. And we just thank you, Lord, as we've welcomed in new members. We can start to do that, Lord. So help us, Lord, to be advocates of your love to all people this week. And so let's go now, and let's go to love one another, because love is from God. And may God the Father, the vine grower, tend you and make you fruitful. May Jesus Christ abide in you and give you life in all its fullness. And may the Holy Spirit cast out all fear and fill you instead with God's love. We go from this place to love and to serve the Lord. Amen.